Hi, my name is Konstantin Baum. I'm a master of wine, a retailer and a consultant. And this is my channel where we are thirsty for knowledge and wine. This segment is called Wine in 10, where I tell you everything you need to know about a region or a grape variety in 10 minutes. Today we are going to talk about a region that has become the gold standard for wines with carbon dioxide, the place that has put the sparkle into sparkling. Well, that sounds pretty stupid. Anyways, Champagne. That's good. Champagne's name comes from the Italian or Latin word Campania, which means open countryside, and it was the first region that really focused on sparkling wines. It has become over the years the model for other regions that are now producing sparkling wines, and its techniques and grape varieties have been copied all around the world. In the early 17th century, the wines from Champagne were not very highly regarded. They were still wines, slightly pink and very light, likely made from the grape variety Pinot Noir. But in the second half of the 17th century, things changed under the influence of monks, particularly under the influence of Dom Pérignon, who worked at the Abbey de Hauteville, who improved the quality of Champagne's wines quite significantly. Many people still believe that Dom Pérignon invented sparkling Champagne, which isn't true. He worked on improving viticultural techniques and worked on the cuvée in the cellar in order to improve the overall quality of still wines from Champagne. So also due to his influence, the wines from Champagne were more highly regarded. They were consumed at the court of Versailles and they were even exported to London. What happened during that time was that the wine was filled in bottle in winter when it was really cold. In spring, the weather changed and the bottle warmed up again, which meant that the yeast started working again, started fermenting the wine that was in bottle, CO2 developed and some bottles exploded, but this was kind of the beginning of fizzy champagne. The English were actually really good at making bottles and they improved the quality of the champagne bottle so that it didn't explode as easily, and all of a sudden sparkling champagne became really popular. A very influential person for the development of sparkling champagne was Madame Clicquot. At her winery they actually invented the riddling or remouage process in order to get the yeast out of the bottle after the fermentation, and she's also credited with making the first rosé champagne in 1818. Another very influential person is Jean-Baptiste François, who developed the recipe in order to make sure that the right amount of sugar was added to the wine in order to induce the second fermentation in bottle. Because of all those inventions, the champagne wine industry really boomed in the 19th century, also fueled by immigrants coming in from the Rhineland who founded wineries like Boulanger, Röderer and Krug. In the early 20th century, however, the wine industry really suffered because of phylloxera and the World War that really caused export markets to collapse. In 1927, the AOC Champagne was first established, and since the Second World War, we've seen a continuous boom for the wines from Champagne. The big growers are getting bigger and bigger, and today 70% of the total production from Champagne is in the hands of 7 producers. But we've also seen another trend where smaller wine growers who have their own vineyards make their own champagne, the so-called grower champagne. If you've ever been to Champagne in winter, then you know that it is a pretty cold region, one of the coldest wine growing regions in Europe, and that is also one of the reasons why it is able to produce such amazing sparkling wines. The region is roughly 34,000 hectares big, and it's the only major wine growing region in France that has only one AOC. The soils are limestone and chalk, and are mainly pretty poor soils that often require fertilization. So let's have a look at the map. So in the north we have the Montagne de Reims with sand, marl and clay soils. Here we have the Vallée de la Marne, which is very important for the production of Pinot Meunier. Here we have the Côte Blanc, which is almost exclusively Chardonnay. And if we move further down south, we have the Côte de Bar, which borders Burgundy and the Côte d'Or. Okay. There's a classification system in Champagne with 320 different crus. There are 17 Grand Crus, 42 Premier Crus and the rest are just Crus. And the value of the grapes that growers sell to the big maisons depends on the quality level of their vineyard. In the past, those prices were fixed depending on the quality or classification level, but today growers can negotiate individually with the big maisons. When it comes to grape varieties in Champagne, the big three are Pinot Noir, Chardonnay and Pinot Meunier. The first two are used all over the world, but Pinot Meunier is planted nowhere else on such a large scale. There are other grape varieties as well that you can use: Pinot Blanc, Pinot Gris, Arban and Petit Meslier, but they are used at a much, much smaller scale. Yields in Champagne have grown quite a bit. There were times when you were only allowed to harvest 3,670 kilograms per hectare in the 1940s. Today, the maximum permitted yield is 15,500 kilograms per hectare, but the region usually sets the maximum at around 10,400 kilograms per hectare, which is still quite a lot. Wine production in Champagne is quite regulated, from the way you're allowed to press the grapes to the way you're allowed to ferment the wine. Most wines are fermented in stainless steel tanks and go through malolactic conversion. You have a base wine after those processes that is still, but you add sugar and yeast to that wine and put it into champagne bottles, close it under a crown cap, and then the second fermentation starts. During that process, alcohol develops, but also CO2 develops, and that's how you get the bubbles into the champagne bottle. When the second fermentation is over, you leave the wine on the yeast for some time. The best wines stay on the yeast for years. Those yeasts add texture to the wine and also a special flavor that is a little bit like bread or like croissants in some cases. Once you're done with that process, you remove the yeast from the bottle, then add a little bit more wine and a little bit sugar in order to make sure that the wine has the desired amount of sweetness. And then you close the bottle with a cork, and that's champagne for you. There are very different styles coming out of Champagne. The most common one is non-vintage Champagne, which is a blend of different vintages and which is supposed to taste the same every year. But there are also vintage wines that tend to be the more expensive, the more luxurious Champagnes. There are also different sweetness or dryness levels. The most common one is Brut with up to 12 grams of residual sugar. But in the last years, there are also more and more drier Champagnes, like the Brut Zero style that has up to 3 grams of residual sugar. I personally find Champagne very interesting. The wines can be exciting or even amazing, and it's probably the wine region in the world that is best at selling their products. Most Champagnes are mass market products that are available everywhere, but they also sell at a very high price. You can see that by the fact that Champagne makes up 9% of the total volume sold in the sparkling wine market in the world, but it makes up 33% of the total value of the sparkling wine market in the world. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, then please like it down here. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already, in order to make sure that you're not missing my upcoming videos. My question of the day is, which one is your favorite champagne? Please comment down here. I hope I see you guys again soon. Until then, stay thirsty.